We want to thank you all for coming to the debate, where we're asking the question, is the UN fair in the treatment of the Israel-Palestine conflict? We had to get some of the best people to answer this question, because it's not an easy one. So we have got the best, I promise you. We've got Hillel Neuer, who's the Executive Director of United Nations Watch, which is an NGO that sits on the Human Rights Council. We have Professor Eric Heinze, an expert on the subject of law and humanities, as he is a professor of the subject at Queen Mary's University. We have Sir Nigel Rodley, who is an extremely respected man in this field, a member of the Human Rights Committee and former head of legal and intergovernmental organisations for Amnesty International. And last but not least, we needed the perfect person to chair. So we have Dr. Rosa Freedman, who is the Professor of Law and Development at the University of Reading. We will not be using the microphone because we don't have enough, so please keep your voices down. There'll be half an hour for introductions, then there'll be another half an hour for rebuttals, and then another half an hour at the end for questions. So please think of some as we go along. Thank you, and have a great night.
Thank you, Sammy. And thank you, Leora, for inviting a very esteemed panel and me to the UCL variety of societies that are here tonight, and I can't remember all their names. Clearly, this is a very interesting and topical debate that never seems to go away. And it's the question of, is the UN fair to Israel and Palestine? And the question can actually be divided into two. I'm sure many of you have many questions from many different angles, but what we're going to do as a format of the evening is to first give our speakers a chance to talk to that one question. I will then come back to them with one or two questions and ask them to reply to one another and to me. And hopefully that will stimulate enough interest and debate that we can then open the floor up to all of you to ask your very many questions. Now, we've been told that we have to be out of the room by 9 o'clock, so we will try and keep very much to time and to succinct questions and discussions from the panellists and from the audience. It's my great pleasure, first of all, to introduce Hillel Neuer, who is the Executive Director of UN Watch, and whom I've known now for 10 years, since the Human Rights Council started. I've known everyone on this panel for a long time. He will, first of all, answer the question.
I'm first. Okay. I want to thank our hosts for organizing this event, and it's a pleasure to be here and privilege to be on a distinguished panel with such eminent scholars. I'm speaking tonight as a practitioner, but very much welcome the discussion this evening. I would like to argue that the United Nations, when it comes to the treatment of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, is not only unfair, but is in material breach of its own charter, which we recently marked 70th anniversary, in which it states that the United Nations guarantees the equal treatment of all nations, large and small. And if we just look at the past year alone, we shall see how so many critical UN organs, institutions, mechanisms, mandates single out Israel for differential and discriminatory treatment in violation of the United Nations' own charter. And I speak tonight as a friend of the United Nations, as the director of UN Watch, whose mission is to uphold the principles and values of the United Nations Charter, and whose founder was Morris Abram, one of the great civil rights leaders of the United States, and someone who served as a UN expert in the 1960s on the subcommission for human rights. And let's just take a look at how the UN has treated the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in the past year, in 2016 alone. If we look in January, the Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon, made some interesting remarks to the Security Council, which he then repeated in an op-ed, a rather exceptional op-ed in the New York Times. And I should note that Ban Ki-moon, when he began his mandate some 10 years ago, was not particularly biased against Israel, but it seems that the position, the nature of the position, given the pressures by 56 Islamic states, including 22 Arab states, which press continually to condemn Israel, and which have enormous leverage over the Secretary General. Indeed, we saw just months ago when Ban Ki-moon issued a report on children killed in armed conflict and listed Saudi Arabia where some 600 children in Yemen were killed by Saudi bombing, and in total some 10,000 civilians have been killed so far, according to the United Nations. And when this report on children listed Saudi Arabia, the Saudis picked up the phone and called Ban Ki-moon, and they said, if you don't take our name out of that report, we're going to cut funding to major UN agencies, we're going to cut funding to the Palestinians, to UNRWA, if you don't remove our name. And Ban Ki-moon went before the media and he said, I'm coming under enormous pressure and I have to save UN agencies and I have no other choice but to delete Saudi Arabia's name from this report because I have to save UN agencies. What is more, other Arab states, allies of Saudi Arabia, also called Ban Ki-moon and said, we're going to issue a fatwa, an Islamic religious decision, to say that the UN is anti-Islamic and essentially to declare a kind of jihad against the United Nations. All of this is reported in Reuters and other UN agencies, and effectively Ban Ki-moon announced it as well. So this is the kind of pressure that he's come under. And so it's not surprising that over time in his 10 years, he increasingly acted with selective concern for human rights. And when you act for selective concern for human rights, you harm the very idea of universal human rights. If human rights are selective, then they are not universal. So it's not only harming Israelis and the denial of their human rights, but it harms the very concept of universal human rights, which we seek to apply worldwide. Ban Ki-moon spoke to the Security Council in January, and while he started by saying that he condemned Palestinian stabbings, car attacks, and shooting against Israelis, he swiftly absolved the terrorists of any moral responsibility by saying, quote, it is human nature to react to occupation. It is human nature to react to occupation. Going further, he drew a narrative in which Palestinian alienation, despair, and frustration are, quote, driving the murder of Israelis. He chastised Israel for, quote, provocative acts, some of which he described as an affront to the Palestinian people. Well, I wrote to the Secretary General and said that, no, it was not human nature for Palestinians in the week preceding his remarks to stab to death Daphna Meir, a mother of six children outside her home, to stab Michal Froman, a pregnant woman, or to stab Shlomit Krigman, a 23-year-old university graduate who died from her wounds on the day of his testimony. The truth is that Palestinian youth are being incited day and night to murder Israelis. And while he did say that, quote, incitement has no place, he deliberately refused to condemn the perpetrators, omitting any mention of the Palestinian Authority, Mahmoud Abbas, Fatah, all of whom have glorified the murderers of Israelis as, quote, martyrs. Likewise, while he did condemn the firing of rockets into Israel, he noticeably declined to name Hamas, Islamic Jihad, or its leaders, sufficing instead with a generic reference to anonymous militant groups. Doubling down, he then published an unprecedented New York Times editorial, which repeated the same one-sided charges, pointing the finger at, quote, senior members of Israel's government. Once again, Hamas and Abbas went unmentioned. Now, as noted by Herb Kanon of the Jerusalem Post, none of Ban Ki-moon's 85 op-eds of the past decade have ever gone after a specific country in this fashion. Not China, not Russia, not Cuba, Iran, Saudi Arabia, or many other regimes were treated in this fashion. They all got a free pass. Instead, when he did write an op-ed on Sudan in regard to Darfur, he actually commended the Sudanese dictator, who's the same man who's wanted by the International Criminal Court for genocide in Darfur, for his, quote, unqualified commitment to support the UN peacekeeping mission. And in the same article, he found reason to shower praise on the late Libyan dictator Muammar Gaddafi for, quote, generously offering to host peace talks and for his, quote, remarkable water pipeline. What a perversion of truth. So that's Ban Ki-moon in January. Then you have March in New York. Every year is the UN Commission on the Status of Women, which routinely includes members such as Saudi Arabia and Iran. And they concluded their annual session in New York by condemning only one country in the world for violating women's rights. No, it was not Saudi Arabia, where women are denied the right to drive a car or require a male guardian to go anywhere, but rather it was Israel that was condemned for allegedly violating the rights of Palestinian women. The Commission on the Status of Women manifested a selective concern for human rights by ignoring Saudi women, ignoring Iranian women who are arrested in the hundreds of thousands for quote-unquote modesty crimes. They ignored Pakistani women who get acid thrown on their faces. They ignored women throughout Africa and other countries where female genital mutilation is practiced. And when they addressed Palestinian women, they of course condemned Israel only and gave a free pass to Palestinian men, Palestinian patriarchal society, where Palestinian women are subjugated and abused in that society, including those who are murdered for the sake of male honor. Third, If we look at in Geneva, where I live and where I work across the street from the Human Rights Council, the highest human rights body, intergovernmental human rights body of the United Nations, made up of 47 members, where, by the way, Saudi Arabia was recently re-elected, and the members include the Chinese Communist Party, the Cuban Communist Party, Burundi, where genocide was warned of recently, and Venezuela, where opposition leaders are thrown into prison. At the Human Rights Council, they adopted 5 resolutions singling out Israel, and 1 on North Korea, 1 on Syria, 1 on Iran, 1 on South Sudan. So 4 on the whole world, 5 against Israel. You might think Syria, where some 300,000-500,000 people have been killed, millions displaced, might merit more attention to Israel, where in the past year, I don't know if more than a dozen Palestinians have been killed, other than those who are, you know, stabbing and shooting. What makes the resolutions on Israel different? It's not just the number 5 on Israel and 4 on the rest of the world combined, but is the fact that the language of these resolutions are different from all the others. Whereas the Human Rights Council found the ability to praise Sudan for its engagement with the UN, the resolutions on Israel are suffused with political hyperbole, selective reporting, and the systematic suppression of any countervailing facts that might provide balance in background information or context. Just 2 other points about the Human Rights Council. There's also 1 agenda item on the whole world, item 4, 1 agenda item on Israel alone. There's a special rapporteur mandate, and with this I conclude. Special rapporteurs, there's about a dozen or 15 on country situations. Only the one on Palestine looks at one side only. It looks at, quote, investigating Israel's violations, and Palestinian abuses are, by definition of the mandate, ignored.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Hillel. I'm now going to pass over to Professor Eric Heinze, who is... I'm now going to pass over to Professor Sir Nigel Rodley, who is a professor at Essex, as stated previously at Amnesty, and who has sat on the UN Human Rights Committee for very many years.
Okay. Thank you very much for the invitation to be here. Thank you all for being here. No, I'm not going to say that the UN is fair to Israel. That would be palpably untrue. The question is how unfair, under what circumstances, and what is the effect of the rhetoric about unfairness. This is something, and I'm going to focus on human rights, not on the Secretary General, not on the Security Council. And it's something that's been going on for something like 50 years now. One of the first articles I ever wrote, which was published in 1971, yes, that's how old I am, was on the UN and human rights in the Middle East. And it was in a special edition of a New York social science journal called Social Research. And the UN, until 1967, didn't take up any situations at all. In 1967, it took up the situation in southern Africa, which mainly meant the colonial countries, or the ones with contested colonial title, like South Africa, in the case of Namibia, and South Africa itself. Then right after the Six-Day War in 1967, the Commission on Human Rights, as it was then, expanded the mandate of the working group on Southern Africa to include the occupied territories of the Middle East, the territories occupied as a result of that war. And they stayed on that for a year or two before the General Assembly, no less, decided to take up the issue and set up a special committee of three governments to investigate the situation. And that committee lasted for decades. Three governments, two of which had no diplomatic relations with Israel, the third of which did, but not for long. And the resolutions by which these mechanisms were adopted or these decisions were taken were all absolutely, as Hillel said, highly prejudicial. They presumed the allegations that were then supposed to be investigated impartially by the bodies that were set up. And, of course, Israel made the most of it, just precisely focusing on the imbalance of approach. They also tried to make a case they were no different from any other sovereign country, but of course they were different from any other sovereign country, and that it wasn't Israel, and despite the way Hillel used Israel all the time, Israel's human rights performance has not been investigated by any of this machinery. It's been its behavior in the occupied territories, which has never been a matter of domestic jurisdiction. But nevertheless, the way they went about it was procedurally totally improper, biased, prejudicial, and of course Israel made good use of that to avoid cooperation with any of the investigations and to refuse access to any of the investigations, and that was it. And so it went on over the decades. In the 1971 article, I found myself pointing out that one of the shames about this was that it was the Israelis were able to use process in order to avoid accounting for collective punishments, for destruction of property, for torture, of which there were very serious allegations, and I have to say, and I was special rapporteur on torture for some 9 years, continuing more than just allegations over that period. The process was one that allowed them to avoid facing the issues and just discuss the bias, which was no doubt absolutely there. And I have to say that I sometimes find myself wondering whether, because the practice has continued. I mean, 45 years later, it's the same. Biased resolutions, unbalanced attention to the issues, the agenda item, the special agenda item on the issue, the special rapporteur now. It's all and prejudicial resolutions. And then, of course, something that Hillel didn't mention, 6 or 7 or 8 of the first dozen or so special sessions of the new Human Rights Council were all in relation to the occupied territories. Now Syria has just about caught up in terms of special sessions on the issue, fortunately, so a weird sort of balance is being restored. But prejudicial resolutions, also with commissions of inquiry that were set up, like the one that led to the Goldstone report, again prejudicial resolutions saying all the violations and crimes that Israel was guilty of, and now let's investigate them. It was almost as though they were feeding off each other. Palestinians and/or their Arab supporters, Middle Eastern supporters, state supporters, ignoring the perfectly legitimate criticism of the process, and of course the Israelis ignoring any discussion of the actual human rights issues at stake, which were real. The second piece I wrote, I only wrote a couple of pieces on the issue. The second one was in 2010, after the Goldstone report, and which I found wanting, not least in terms of the incredibly biased mandate that was given it. Since Hillel quoted stuff he'd said. I'll allow myself, especially at my age, to quote what I said at the end of that piece. The fact remains that the concerns about substance are real, and the report's identification of them deserves study. For example, they relate to certain neighborhoods in which persons identified by the Israelis as non-combatants, mainly women and children, are given conflicting instructions about where to go and then to find themselves the object of shooting by Israeli forces. In one case, a handcuffed individual was shot, family members were prevented from assisting him, and all attempts to get Palestinian Red Crescent or ICRC assistance to him were rejected. He bled to death. It's a crying shame, in my view, that the UN has not been ever able to put together a proper look into Israel, into the Israeli occupied territories. The closest thing they come to impartiality is UPR, Universal Periodic Review, but that doesn't involve corporate judgment by the Human Rights Council itself. In an own goal, for the first year, Israel refused to cooperate with it on the grounds that the UN was biased against Israel, the Human Rights Council was biased against Israel, when UPR was the only non-biased process available in the whole system, and eventually Israel changed its mind about that, fortunately. But the sad result is that we have this continuing... I'm finishing. I think I'm on my last sentence. We have this continuing cat and mouse, and it's probably something worse than that, in which serious things are going on, things of which Israel has no basis to be proud, and whose own internal mechanisms have proven incapable of getting at them. And I say that from two different perspectives of absolute impartial activity by the UN. There's no real accountability in terms of fact-finding at the international level. And a lot of the justification for the non-cooperation with those processes is by the... I'd like to think it's stupid, but I suspect it's worse than that. By those proposing the resolution, setting up the investigations, not being interested in the truth either. Thank you.
Thank you, Sir Nigel. Next we have Professor Eric Heinze from Queen Mary University, an expert in human rights and in the United Nations Human Rights Council. Having read my book very many times during my PhD. Over to you.
Thank you, and thank you everybody. A question, just to repeat, is whether the UN is fair in its treatment of Israel and Palestine. I'd like to reformulate the question. Imagine if we were to ask, is the United Nations just? In other words, does it treat the Israel-Palestine situation with justice? Because, in fact, we then end up with two conflicting models of justice and evidence in the United Nations, and I mean deeply conflicting, never reconcilable, although this is pretty much never acknowledged, it tends to be smoothed over. The first model of justice would be, we could call a model of justice as absolute fairness. When I say absolute, I don't mean perfect. Of course, no complex human institution can work perfectly. When I say absolute fairness, it's, in other words, justice implemented in such a way that the organization or its human rights bodies would proceed against all states solely in proportion to levels of abuse. This we could call a kind of classical rule of law model. It would assume a formal sovereign equality of all member states or states parties to a given treaty, and we could even extend that formal sovereign equality to certain non-state actors, Palestinian Authority or what have you. And therefore, material inequalities would never trump formal sovereign equality. In other words, when it comes to questions of certain states having fewer resources, therefore being less able to implement to the standard you might find in Denmark or Norway, and perhaps having less fewer resources because of, say, an imperial past, a recent or any sort of or a war or any sort of situations which might put inflammation beyond its beyond its control, all of those problems which make it, in a sense, unequal to other sovereigns materially would always be taken into account. And we see this in some of the, let's say, better human rights bodies, like the treaty-based committees, which will say, well, okay, you know, such and such prima facie violences have occurred, but nevertheless, such and such a country has to deal with certain situations outside of its control. But indeed, as Nigel had just mentioned, these sorts of bodies at the United Nations, which could adhere to a criterion of absolute fairness, again, we proceed against all states even-handedly, solely in proportion to levels of abuse, we tend to really only find them in the mechanisms that have no teeth, like universal periodic review at the Human Rights Council, or the work of the various treaty-based committees. In other words, in terms of its effectivity, the standard of justice's absolute fairness is purely aspirational, or largely aspirational. The second model I would call a model of justice as institutional feasibility. In other words, we simply accept from the outset that the United Nations is not perfect, its members are not perfect, we have all sorts of different countries, we have voting blocs, we have lots of non-democracies, we have lots of corruption, and therefore all we try to do is look for what's achievable, what's pragmatic, compromise as and when, keep within our souls a kind of spirit of progressive reform as and when. That model of institutional of justice as institutional feasibility would entail what we could call a model of relative fairness, not absolute fairness. In other words, material inequalities between sovereigns do override formal sovereign equality, right? In other words, the idea that, for example, a certain country has a colonial past, I think this is probably the chief way in which material inequality comes to trump, to override formal sovereign equality. If there is an imperial past, a colonial past, then that is seen as reason to give more attention to states, usually within the West, who may not. And then, of course, Israel is seen as a kind of paradigm of an ongoing settler colonialism. Of course, we know this is a much more complicated claim, but we're talking here about justifications, and this is a very common justification, the kind of, right, of this post-colonial matrix, which means that material inequality can trump formal sovereign equality. Now, I think that if you ask the average human rights practitioner, indeed the average human rights teacher, usually there's this kind of vague idea that this can all be reconciled. You know, something along the lines of, yes, well, of course, we would like absolute fairness, and we strive for it, and we hope for it, but nevertheless, we're in the so-called real world, and we have to be pragmatic and do whatever we can, and something is better than nothing, right? That's kind of the fudge, right, that you constantly hear from the human rights community. It's kind of painting the best face on it. It can all work out, and we just do the best we can. And what, of course, goes missing is that's just false, right? Once you balance absolute fairness against relative fairness, you only have relative fairness. That's what it means to balance, right? To balance an absolute with a relative. You only then have relative fairness, which, again, as Hillel says, for human rights, that can only be unfairness by definition. There's no concept of human rights which could ever support a notion of relative fairness. In other words, where the concept of absolute fairness, in other words, even-handed application solely in proportion to levels of abuse would somehow be overthrown or overridden. And so the question was, how can this be? And why does anyone notice this? And why does everyone just kind of go on in their kind of practitioner's vein? And I would argue that, in fact, the United Nations has never had a system of human rights. This is mostly a rhetorical term. What it has is a system of human goods, and that's not a slight difference. It has a system of human rights, maybe with respect to members, again, like the Netherlands or Denmark and Sweden, and that's about where it starts and stops, and that has always been the case. For virtually all of its membership, it is simply a system of human goods, which are by no means practiced as rights, nor can they be. Simply the fact that you come up with a universal declaration or a number of charters which recite certain things, then you throw them into an institutional context, does not mean that you have created a system of rights. This is just a mistake that human rights practitioners make all the time, and they're likely to keep making it. Just because the rhetoric of human rights lends a kind of moral authority that a rhetoric of human goods would simply dilute. And this is a reason why it's because everyone kind of pays lip service to absolute fairness, but in fact that is necessarily institutionally factored out of human rights practice, and in fact we only get this relative fairness, which is incompatible with any notion of human rights, that I think we get what therefore end up being unsurprising attitudes towards a country like Israel. I think if you talk to a lot of the sort of UN types, you'll kind of get this acknowledgement, even among those who are quite critical of Israel, who kind of support a lot of these resolutions. I think, yes, well, we know, yeah, maybe there's a bit too much focus on Israel, but nevertheless, there are really abuses there, and there's nothing illegitimate in principle in looking at them. You hear this all the time. And in other words, what you're hearing when this is said is the value of relative fairness. There's no real acknowledgement of absolute fairness in there at all, of this kind of rule of law fairness. It's just not a factor at all. In other words, what we might see as an unfairness on an absolute standard actually becomes a fairness. It actually becomes a fairness. In fact, the Israel-Palestine situation, far from undermining UN human rights practice, which it would do under a standard of absolute fairness, in fact, reaffirms it. And therefore, on a standard of relative fairness, it therefore, abracadabra, turns out that you can be non-absolutely, you can treat Israel with non-absolute fairness, and yet still see it as fair, still see it as reaffirming a different kind of fairness. And so I'll finish because I can pick up some of the other things later on. And so this is one reason why, in a sense, we shouldn't even be surprised. And to call it's unfair is to assume that there's a standard of fairness which was never designed to be there. It was never designed to be there. The only way it could have ever have been is if, for example, the United Nations did not assume human rights in a kind of transcendentalist discourse to apply to all states regardless of political regime. That would be impossible, because then any possibility for applying a standard of absolute fairness just disappears. And so we shouldn't be surprised by it. In fact, it's logical and inevitable when, no matter how much lip service is paid, it's in fact a logic of relative fairness that has only ever been applied. I'll stop there, and yeah, there's more to say.
Thank you very much to all of our speakers for your opening remarks. I think the theme that's coming up from all of you is around equality and fairness, justice. You know, what does it actually mean? And going to your opening remarks, Hillel, you talk about the UN Charter says there will be equal treatment of states. The UN Charter also says that it will be open, the UN, to peace-loving states. We know that there are ideals that are set out in the UN Charter throughout the Charter that the UN seeks to live up to aspire to, but that haven't been actualised in its first 70 years. But then we come to sort of the broader question of what is equality? Is it equal that Israel is a sovereign state and Palestine a non-state entity, right? Is there equality in the treatment of that situation as compared to the treatment of a domestic human rights situation? Because Nigel was talking to the fact that this is about Israel and Palestine, the occupation, not about looking at Israel's domestic human rights record. Or is it fair, is it just to then compare that with the situation of human rights abuses during an armed conflict? what are we talking about when we're talking about equal treatment? Are we saying that all states have to be treated equally all the time? Or that they should be treated as Eric was going to, sort of this idea of you have different lenses, different ways of treating them depending on what's going on within that state at any time, unless they are Denmark or Sweden or the Netherlands, all of which also have serious human rights abuses, as we see, but maybe just not to the gravity and scale that many other countries around the world do. So I think those ideas come out, and I only want to pick up on two other points. I think the issues around Saudi Arabia and around political pressures and the issues around resolutions generally that Nigel and Hillel were talking to are very real. The UN is a political body made up of member states, and I wonder whether the standards that you're trying to hold the UN to when we talk about fairness can be expected from a political rather than an expert body, which you all were talking about, the expert bodies, which are very different. And the second point is, I remember Ban Ki-moon coming into the Human Rights Council and pleading with it to stop at the beginning, as Nigel was saying, at the beginning the Human Rights Council was so really focused on Israel to the extent that it didn't have other special sessions or anything else, and there was a genocide in Darfur, and Ban Ki-moon pleaded with the Human Rights Council to please stop focusing on Israel and look at human rights abuses elsewhere. And I wonder to what you think might have changed. It can't solely be the political pressures. What might have changed over the course of his 10-year stewardship of this body that he then, as you said, Hillel, came out and wrote this very strong op-ed in a way that he's never criticised any other country. So I will leave you to reply to one another and to my thoughts in the same order, starting with you, please, Hillel.
Thank you, and I'll just use some of my time just to continue some of the list that I wanted to mention. Just take a moment. I mentioned three examples, and just in bullet points, the fourth example from this year in March was the appointment of Michael Link, Canadian law professor, to the position of special rapporteur of Palestine. Michael Link was asked in his application, "Is there anything in your record that might cast doubt on your impartiality?" And his response was, "Absolutely not. Anything that would call into question your objectivity, absolutely not. No, no, no," three or four times. And you just do a Google search for Michael Link, and you see that Michael Link is the regular opening speaker for Israel Apartheid Week in Canada. He is the member of three pro-Palestinian lobby groups. In the 1990s, he went to Parliament Hill to lobby against free trade with Israel. He speaks at one-state conferences. If Michael Link is not biased, then no one in the world is biased. And he wouldn't mention even a word of this in his application. Actually, they changed the application after this catastrophe of dishonesty to ask more specific questions about all of these things. But he was appointed special rapporteur. And to the credit of Canada, which recently elected a center-left government, Foreign Minister Stéphane Dion criticized his appointment and called for a review of his appointment, which we're still waiting for. And we haven't heard anything from the UN about Michael Link, who's now the special rapporteur. In April, we had UNESCO, which adopted one of the resolutions this year on Jerusalem, where they said that Temple Mount, where the holiest site in Judaism, in effect, has no connection with Judaism. They called it Haram al-Sharif, did not use the word Temple Mount, to suggest that it's only an Islamic site. They also accused Israel of a wild conspiracy notion that Israel is, quote, planting fake Jewish graves in Jerusalem. Well, I looked on the internet, and there's no one in the world who says that other than Hamas websites. And that's why France apologized three times for having voted for that resolution. President Hollande, Prime Minister Manuel Valls, and Interior Minister Cazeneuve apologized for having voted yes and then changed their vote in October. And then you had May, the World Health Organization. By the way, UNESCO routinely adopts 10 resolutions against Israel and usually zero resolutions on any other country in the world. Recently, there's been one resolution on Crimea regarding Russia's actions there, but that's it, only Israel. In May, we had the World Health Organization. Only one country in the world is singled out as a violator of health rights, that's Israel. So Syria and Russia have bombed the last operating hospitals in Aleppo, not a word about them, but there is mention of Syria in the resolution against Israel, accused Israel of violating the health rights of Syrians in the Golan, which is absurd. Then you have, in June, you have the International Labour Organization, meets for their annual session. Sure enough, there's a major 100-page report every year on Israel. No other country in the world has that report. Number eight, in September, we had the High Commissioner take the floor during a session of the Human Rights Council, and he lumped Israel in the same category as Syria and Iran and North Korea for non-cooperation, even though, as you heard from this panel, the processes against Israel are all prejudicial and selective. The Office of the High Commissioner is a very important body, as Sir Nigel can tell you. They're the ones who support the work of the Human Rights Council. They're the civil service and for the treaty bodies. And yet the Human Rights Council, when they wanted to hire someone to do the drafting of the Goldstone Report in 2009, the report on the 2009 Gaza conflict, they chose Grecia Bars, who's a law professor here in London, who might be the most anti-Israel person in the world. She, for 5 years prior to taking this job as an impartial civil servant of the UN, spent 5 years approximately in the Palestinian territories, where she was teaching Palestinians how to pursue Israelis in international courts. She then became the spokeswoman for the flotilla against Israel. She drafted key portions of the Goldstone Report. So that's the Office of the High Commissioner. Number nine, the UN General Assembly is in session now. They're adopting 20 resolutions on Israel and 4 on the rest of the world combined. Number 10, the Security Council. You often hear from people like William Chabas, who, to his disgrace, had to resign because he had done paid legal work for the PLO. He had to resign from his role as chair of the Commission of Inquiry to the 2014 Gaza conflict. People like Chabas say, well, yes, all of those things may be true, but the Security Council is pro-Israel because of the U.S. veto. Well, that's a myth. The fact is that the Security Council numerous times has criticized Israel and never specifically condemns the Palestinians, has never adopted a resolution on China, Russia, Cuba, and so forth, and actually has condemned Israel on many occasions. When Israel took out the Iraqi nuclear reactor, much to the welcoming of Western countries like the UK and the US, who were active in the Gulf War, they were condemned by the Security Council. 10 years later, US Secretary of Defense Dick Cheney apologized for having joined in that condemnation. So the truth is that Israel is singled out every month at the UN. And just one word, if you'll permit me, Sir Nigel said that Israel likes to make accusations of bias but doesn't cooperate. Actually, during the Goldstone Report in July of 2009, while it was being written, though they did not formally cooperate, they published a very substantial response of which I wrote to Goldstone and said, "Dear Goldstone, you know, it's on the internet, I hope you see this." And that report was cited in the Goldstone Report, but only to refute it a number of times. So it was, when Israel does cooperate with a significant amount of substance, they are ignored. You said it's a crying shame that certain Israeli alleged abuses are ignored. Why is it not a crying shame that Hamas in Gaza, which oppresses their people, oppresses gays and women, why isn't it a crying shame that the UN ignores those victims? And it's, if we care about Palestinian abuses, it's also about what Hamas does. They're the rulers of Gaza. Fatah rules in Ramallah and Nablus and Hebron. Why is it a crying shame that the UN ignores those victims?
Thank you. Nigel, over to you.
I like the, if I may first go back to Eric's point, and he's right, governments have a habit of behaving like governments, so one shouldn't be too surprised. It does raise the question, since it is absolutely inevitable that governments behave like governments, it's not just Israel, or the Israel in respect of the occupied territories, I insist, that is on the receiving end, and not just the Palestinians and or their Arab neighbours who are on the benefiting end. There are others as well. Until the fall of the generals in Argentina, Argentina was immune, despite the fact that it was disappearing people by the thousands. Until it invaded Kuwait, Iraq was immune. I was still at Amnesty when I submitted a dossier under the confidential human rights procedure on Iraq. I don't think I ever remembered submitting anything that was that had more blood in it. It was horrifying. No action was taken on Iraq. The Subcommission on Human Rights, proposed that some action be taken by the Commission on China. China had the votes in the Commission, which was intergovernmental, to take no action there, and that's the last we heard of China. And this was on the heels of Tiananmen, so it wasn't just everyday China that we're talking about. And then, of course, the Saudi that everybody ignores. So is the whole system, yes, is biased in terms of absolute fairness of the sort that Eric was talking about. And that means we're left with a question as to how far we should just forget the system as a whole or not. My own suggestion would be that even though Argentina seemed to escape scot-free, Iraq seemed to escape scot-free, China as a permanent member of the Security Council, frankly, all of them are going to escape scot-free of everything all the time. So the whole UN is structured to give immunity to those five, the P5. But I would put it to you that when push came to shove and Argentina invaded the Falklands, they found themselves far more friendless than they expected to be because of the human rights record that had surfaced and indeed been ignored by the UN, with the ignoring of it being part of the newsworthiness of the human rights situation. I would suggest to you that the same would be true of Iraq and Kuwait, that there wouldn't have been that much support for this little enclave south of Iraq had it not been for the notoriety of Iraq's human rights performance, partly as a result of the refusal of the UN to deal with it, and so on. So just because the UN doesn't act doesn't mean it isn't an important forum for surfacing the issues. And so I would caution against just dismissing the whole project out of hand, though a case could be made, and I've made it myself, that the only human rights bodies that should come to any conclusions are expert ones, not intergovernmental ones. There is a case to be made for that. Is Israel disproportionately affected even by those standards, or Israel in respect of the occupied territories? Yes, it probably is, though of course it's not, as I've said, just a domestic situation. Two last points. I'm sorry that Hillel felt it necessary to attack Zaid too. This is a high commissioner who's been more outspoken on more human rights situations in more parts of the world, including the one he comes from, than any other high commissioner that we've had. And what was the criticism? Non-cooperation. Well, you may or may not feel that non-cooperation is justified by the prejudice. I'm not sure that non-cooperation is justified by the prejudice. It's a nice excuse, but it isn't necessarily justified. And finally, Hamas. Yes, if you treat it as a state entity rather than a terrorist organization, then it probably should be being investigated. But otherwise, the case may be somewhat less clear. Certainly when it comes to the armed conflict dimensions between the two, then it is up for some investigation, though I certainly accept that the Goldstone report would be an example of not taking the case against Hamas as seriously, the allegations against Hamas as seriously as the allegations against Israel. But that's a different issue again. I'll stop there.
Thank you.
Right. I think one of the problems is that, right, just starting with many of the charges that Hillel has recited, right, a big problem is that it ends up being a kind of shopping list, and it could be, if Hillel had twice as much time, he probably could have kept going, right? Because it's a kind of factual recitation. And the problem is that when you're reciting this to many people, the people who we most need to convince, you're going to be talking through them. You're going to be talking past each other. Why? Because again, this is assuming a standard. These charges, this long list of charges, only make sense when we're assuming a standard, which I'm calling absolute fairness, which is not the standard anybody is using. right? You're talking to people whom you need to convince, generally speaking, who are deeply steeped within post-colonial theory, and post-colonial view of the world, a view of the world in which the West is fundamentally responsible, and often correctly so. Again, I'm not picking sides on all the post-colonial theory, it's very complicated, but which the West has an enormous history to answer for, which has to fundamentally inform the way we approach something like human rights, and where Israel is now the ongoing embodiment of that, right? And of course, all of that atop, right, a long history of villainizing Jews in one way or the other. And so the problem is, it's not enough just to recite all these charges because they're assuming a standard of fairness that's not being assumed. The standard of fairness being assumed, again, is one of relative fairness, which takes things like this post-colonial context into account, and we have to be able to talk at that level. We have to be able to not just ignore the post-colonial theory, not just try to avoid it, but engage with it and explain how its conclusions are still not the conclusions that we see at the UN. And this argument is made too little, right? The idea is that somehow post-colonial theory is the enemy. It's not the enemy. It has to be engaged with and shown how its own practitioners, its own theorists, actually very much manipulated and misapplied. Back to Rosa's question, right? Don't we just have to accept it's all politics? Even look at the charter, right? Peace-loving, everyone knows that that's not applied at all sorts of norms that are either not applied or applied so randomly one could never tell. Well, let's look at it this way. I mean, no better context to raise this whole UN question than the human rights context, particularly when we recall that what we understand as the contemporary human rights movement is so much a child of things like the Holocaust, the Nuremberg Trials, and so forth. Somehow genocide became the paradigm case for understanding things like a human rights movement and understanding things like the purposes of the United Nations. Now, it's funny because when we look at genocides, whether it's the Nazi genocide, whether it's under Chairman Mao, the Cultural Revolution, whether it's the Stalinist purges and so forth, when we look at these, right, again, with a kind of safe benefit of history, right, we have this idea, we're thinking people like Hannah Arendt and so forth, right, of a kind of casual complicity, right, this famous banality of evil, right, where you have the occasional few who stand up and often they're just, you know, kind of dealt with in short order, but you have a whole population which is just socialized into complicity. Now, how shall we apply that to the United Nations? Right? Again, as Rosa's own book states, and as we've heard here, right, this constant attention to Israel, the Human Rights Council, means that genocides have been ignored, have been taken off the agenda, right? Rosa has this all in her book, right? The Darfur situation, the Congo situation, either genocides or gross and massive and systemic crimes against humanity, right, where you can count the victims in the millions, all of this taken off. And again, the standard practitioner's retort will be, well, yeah, of course, we have to do the best we can, and you know, it's not perfect, and all these cliches which keep, you know, the system going. At what point do we say, no, this is complicity? At what point, if two genocides were not enough, at what point do we say, no, you know, it's looking a little, you know, like Nazism, or like Stalinism, or like Maoism, at what point, if two genocides were enough, do we say, no, you're not being pragmatic. You're not just engaging in necessary compromises at the UN, you are actively complicit. At what point? So I can only, in keeping with our great tradition, answer the question of the question.
thank you very much. Should we open up the floor to some questions from you all? Hopefully, Hillel, you've finished your presentation, you'll answer some questions this time, right? I don't have any microphones, but yeah. This gentleman at the front. No, over here. Right at the front.
It's good. Hello. Thank you for a great presentation, everyone. My question is specifically for Hillel, who I very much enjoy watching at the United Nations, telling the truth in public in front of all the country's representatives who are horrified by everything you're saying and continually trying to stop you whilst you're saying it. I'm very interested because of what you do. Do you have, does your group, does the United Nations group that you work for, get threats? Do you personally get threats? Are you in danger? Because you're having a go at a lot of countries that are very pissed off with you on a regular basis. So what, do you get threats essentially?
I don't like to comment publicly about my security situation, but Geneva is a place where normally at the UN there are, it is rare for there to be physical altercations at the United Nations. There was one incident where a Cuban diplomat ran after an American diplomat who was of Cuban origin and tackled him to the ground and started beating him up. And the U.S. ambassador, a former U.S. Marine, then broke it up and sort of apprehended the Cuban aggressor, but UN security let him go because he had diplomatic immunity. I will share with you a serious incident that happened, which will somewhat address what you raised, which is that a few years ago, we're talking about Israel here, and my organization, UN Watch, holds the UN to account, and we promote human rights, and we bring leading dissidents, people who are just been released from prison in Iran, China, Cuba, Venezuela, to speak at the United Nations. We're having our annual, ninth annual Geneva Summit for Human Rights on February 21st, and you're all invited. It's really a wonderful event. You meet the Nelson Mandelas of today. We have the two leading Russian dissidents. The didn't announce it yet, but I'll announce it here. The daughter of Boris Nemtsov, who was assassinated, she'll be coming, and some other very courageous champions of human rights. And we brought, a few years ago, Tiana Wang, whose father, Wang Binzhang, is in prison in China. He's the father of China's democracy movement. He was abducted while he had left China. He was living in Canada. He was visiting the Far East. I think it was in Vietnam. He was abducted, thrown into prison, solitary confinement. He's been languishing there for many years. And we brought his daughter, who lives in Montreal, is a law student at McGill University, to testify at the Human Rights Council. And while she was there, sitting in the back after she had spoken, a Chinese gentleman who was wearing an NGO badge, and who I had spotted with a group of six or seven of them, who didn't look like your usual human rights activists. They looked like mafia types, actually. Well, he was going behind her and taking pictures of her, with his iPad, of her computer, of her body. UN security, to their credit, apprehended him, took him outside, found these pictures, and nothing happened. I think at the end of the session, at the last day or two, they removed his credentials. It was clear, you can watch the video, that he was conspiring with about six others who had come with fake NGO badges, meaning the UN recognized their group as an NGO. It was called a group NGO for Tibetan development or something. And to the credit of the New York Times reporter in Beijing, she picked up on the story. She went to visit the address, the official address of this so-called Tibetan human rights group. And she shows up in Beijing, and it's basically the Chinese Pentagon is the address, okay? The Chinese defense security establishment, and some guy comes with sunglasses and says, what do you want? Yeah, I'm the representative of that group. And she did two different stories on it, but nothing happened at the United Nations. This group was not really penalized, and China, which obviously sent these spies to intimidate our witness, China went away scot-free. So those kinds of things do happen in Geneva. And there are forms of intimidation that aren't necessarily physical, but that are wielded against human rights activists.
Just before we go to the next question, just to add to that, I mean, you're laughing about that, and it is quite funny, sort of, that she turned up to the Pentagon. But as you know, and as we all know in the human rights world, human rights defenders around the world that try to get the Human Rights Council from China recently, human rights defender was being brought to the Human Rights Council to testify, was put in prison, and ended up dying. Hillel's organization has brought out many people from Darfur, from North Korea, from across the world. But it's not a fun game. And if you're a human rights defender in one of these countries, the fear of reprisals is a very real one. And the reprisals won't just be against you, but also against your family. Sorry, lady over here.
I've got a comment. A comment and a couple of questions for Eric. The first comment is basically to agree with Nigel. I would agree, I think you were saying that I think this whole issue is a double-edged sword. I would agree that the UN is biased against Israel. And that's obviously not good for Israel, but it's also not good for the Palestinians, or anybody really. It adds an element to the narrative which enables Israel to change, or anyone to change the conversation that we can focus on bias instead of actual serious human rights abuses on both sides. And so the tragedy is this isn't good for Israel, it's not good for the Palestinians, and it's really not good for the UN. Turning to Eric, a couple of questions. First thing is, I wonder what you call absolute fairness. So I just wonder what that could possibly look like. For a start, economic, social, and cultural rights are relative. You can't have absolute fairness. And you know, that's half of human rights. Does that just mean that all we do is sit around and criticise North Korea? Until we criticise them enough and then we move on to the next. I was also interested that you seem to concede that absolute fairness, or at least a version of it, at least almost exists in the treaty bodies and UPR, and then you dismiss them as toothless. Why do you think the Human Rights Council is not toothless? I mean, it is. Why is the Human Rights Council, I mean, UPR is part of the Human Rights Council. Why is the Human Rights Council so much stronger? Why do you presume, I mean, and especially in the Human Rights Council, of all of those bodies, is the one we can't expect absolute fairness from. It is blatantly political, and so, you know, that's what I would say. And so, in terms of all the UN bodies, which one is actually strong? Well, the Security Council. And I'm not sure I would agree with Hillel there, that I think, it's okay, the Security Council has condemned Israel. I note that you went back to 1981, for example. There's been very serious incidents then, and the resolutions do get vetoed by the US. It's not the only country that's protected on the Security Council, but it is largely protected. And the Security Council, compared to the Human Rights Council, compared to the treaty bodies, that's the powerful one. I don't see the Human Rights Council as being more powerful than the treaty bodies.
Yeah, thank you for the questions. First, what is absolute fairness? Yeah. Maybe just a phrase that somehow needs to be tweaked. As I said, it doesn't mean perfect, of course. Right? It doesn't mean perfect fairness, again. But I say, I don't use the word absolute because in other words, there would be no conceivable deviation from it, which could be called fairness, right? And so again, it's, we proceed against all, well, just leave it states, non-state actors, leave aside, right? Just to keep it simple, or sovereigns. We proceed against all states solely in proportion to levels of abuse, right? And the standard is absolute. Of course, in practice, there's going to be questions of judgment and disagreement. Yeah, so I don't mean perfect, right? And what I mean is that there's no competing norm which would compromise it. There's no competing norm which would compromise it, right? And that applies equally to social and cultural rights, right? Because as I said, material inequalities just get factored into assessments. And we see this in committee work. As to teeth, my criterion is not so much whether they have armies or prisons, because you're right, on that criterion, they're all toothless. I think the treaty-based committees really only exist in a human rights universe, right? I mean, again, this is, well, I'm happy to make an exception for Sweden, right? Sweden, the Netherlands, they really will take seriously what what any of you say, and right, and they'll follow it and implement it, right? And so why? Who cares, right? When the whole world becomes Sweden's and Netherlands, we'll see if we need a United Nations at all, right? But nevertheless, the Human Rights Council, UNESCO, for example, right? These have a profile, which again, many educated but not specialized people have heard of UNESCO. None of them even know the Human Rights Committee or the Committee on Children or Women even exists. They exist in a little human rights bubble, right? With a couple of government people.
They're cited by courts, whereas UNESCO and Human Rights Committee.
All right, okay, listen.
They never are. They are not legally
binding.
The Human Rights Committee, etc. They are cited by courts in many different
countries. I agree with everything you're saying from a strict black letter point of view. From the point of black letter law, you're absolutely right. I won't dispute that.
But actual law actual law applied by courts that is actually applied in whereas UNESCO's never cited.
I think you're just talking different lenses. One's talking from law, one's talking from public perception. Can I just offer Hillel the chance to come back on the Security Council point?
It is absolutely a myth that Israel has immunity at the Security Council, which people like William Chabas and Walter Mearsheimer and Richard Falk and many others say. You asked why I picked 1981. It's just the most absurd and obvious case that people know about. I have in front of me a 10-page paper, which I don't think we published, which I prepared a few years ago, and I'll be happy to email it to you afterwards, which is 10 pages of condemnations of Israel, or criticisms of Israel of various kinds, both in the form of presidential statements and in resolutions. June 2010, presidential statement criticizing Israel about the flotilla. 2007, presidential statements targeting Israel regarding things happening in Lebanon. Three presidential statements in Israel in 2006, and resolutions as well. Here there's resolutions in resolution 1435 in 2002, 1322 in 2000. What you pointed to is the fact that the United States vetoes a number of resolutions. And that actually is very misleading, because Israel has never been on the Security Council, and so never gets to introduce a resolution. But there's always an Arab country in the U.S. Council, and they always introduce resolutions against Israel all the time. So the fact that the Arab countries, by rote, every year introduce 10 or 15 one-sided, unbalanced, and often inflammatory resolutions, and the United States does the right thing to maintain balance and to veto those resolutions, is an indication of nothing but that, for example, Egypt now in the Security Council is instructed by the Palestinians to introduce these resolutions. What you don't see is the introduction of resolutions on other situations where you might see that. You might have that similar situation. We had it exceptionally where the United States decided to introduce resolutions on Syria, knowing that they would be vetoed, and they were vetoed. And very few people ever say that the Security Council is pro-Syrian. But if that's your measure, the Security Council is very pro-Syrian, very pro-Russian, and pro, you know, 100 other countries that never get criticized, whether it's Turkey. And, you know, I have a long list here. I don't need to mention whether it's Turkey, Sri Lanka, Venezuela, and many other abuses. Venezuela has elected a member of the Security Council. So it is absolutely a myth that Israel has immunity at the Security Council, and the fact that the Arab states routinely introduce these resolutions is not a measure of anything. But it is true that the United States uses its veto power often, but not always. And actually, we know in the next couple months, President Obama may not exercise the veto, and actually, even George W. Bush at times did not exercise the veto and abstained on certain resolutions. So it is a myth that the Security Council is somehow controlled by AIPAC, which I heard when I spoke in Cambridge. I'll end there.
There's a gentleman over here. Do you need a mic?
Thank you, gentlemen, for a most thought-provoking presentation. It's clear from what you've said, and maybe it's an understatement, that the UN is a somewhat flawed body. And it does have some good bits, although those have been hardly mentioned. Clearly it has other bits that are not so good. First part of my question is, on balance, do you feel the good outweighs the not so good? And assuming you do, because if it, you believe it doesn't, then clearly there's no point in having the UN. And also, you gentlemen will be looking for something else to occupy your time. If there are good bits and bad bits, is there any added value to the world in splitting up the good bits from the bad bits? And which part would fit into which category?
Nigel, we haven't heard from you yet. Should we start with you?
Okay, let me have a go. And I also want to say another couple of things too while I've got the floor. Yes, inevitably, I think there are good bits as well as bad bits. I think the special procedure system of the UN Human Rights Council, previously the UN Human Rights Commission, had its good bits because the work was done by individual experts acting in their personal capacity. Like I said, I was the UN Special Rapporteur on torture for 9 years. And I've never really been accused of being politically selective, not even by Israel, and sometimes I had quite substantial sections on allegations against Israel in my annual report. The more interesting, the harder question is, can you separate them off? And I'm not sure you can, I'm not sure you can separate the political cover that the intergovernmental body, the Human Rights Council, gives to the individual experts, the special procedures, the special rapporteurs, from the work that they do. They have to be created by somebody, and the only bodies with authority to create them are political bodies. So the only alternative option, I think, and I've already referred to it, though I'm not sure it's politically on the cards, is for the intergovernmental bodies themselves not to try and get in on the act of finger-pointing at individual states. I'd like to come in just very briefly on the teeth business, inevitably in support of Sarah. I think Eric was a bit patronising, talking about, well, maybe Sweden or Norway. Recently, we were informed both by the claimant and by the government that a woman in Peru, an indigenous woman, I think, who'd been denied an abortion because it, even though it may have been illegal, the doctors were too scared to give it to her, and she had to carry a fetus with a fatal abnormality to term, had her rights under the covenant violated. And we're now informed that she has in fact been given compensation pursuant to the decision. Now, are all of our decisions crowned with such success? Of course they're not. But I think you also have to just be a little bit careful of dismissing it all out of hand as toothless. But it is true that the Human Rights Council has more political clout than the treaty bodies. That there's no doubt about. I'd like, if I may, just to ask a question of Hillel, because I have seen some of the stuff they've done on human rights and found it quite good, and I approve of the process of bringing people to testify about serious human rights violations to the United Nations. But I get very irritated when people's concern with human rights is selective, for example, just against Israel. So that when the NUT adopts the National Union, I didn't mean NUT. Yes, I do. The university teachers, AUT, adopts resolutions saying that one should consider cooperation with Israeli academia. I cooperate a lot with Israeli academia, and I'm co-editor-in-chief of the Israel Law Review, on the grounds of the human rights policy. Among the reasons I get irritated with them is, and make it very clear I'm not going to have anything to do with what they have to suggest, is that that's the only human rights situation they seem to be concerned about. Are there any human rights situations that UN Watch is not concerned about? Has it, for example, done anything on Israeli human rights issues?
Sir Nigel, I don't believe you're really against what you call selective NGOs. You know, tonight we're talking about the United Nations, which is...
Really? I'm not. I'm not being honest.
Let me finish. Let me explain. Tonight we've talked about the United Nations, and the question was, is the United Nations fair? And the United Nations is obliged to be fair according to its charter. And we expect the United Nations to act as the Human Rights Council promised when it was reformed in 2006 with non-selectivity. We do not ask advocacy groups to be universal. We have hundreds of advocacy groups that focus on particular situations. My founder, who you may have known, Morris.
I did, yeah.
Yeah. So as you may know...
I respected him very much.
Thank you. As you may know...
No. I respected him very much.
As his successor, I thank you for your kind words about our founder. As you know, he was a great civil rights leader, and he helped get Martin Luther King out of prison, and he won the 1963 case of Gray versus Saunders, and he was head of the United Negro College Fund in the United States. Now, when Martin Luther, and in his gravestone, he says, the epitaph on his gravestone is that he fought for the principle in constitutional law of one man, one vote. And the fact that Morris Abram devoted the early part of his career to fighting against selectivity, the discrimination against black people, you never faulted Morris Abram for dedicating a good part of his life to organizations and causes that fight against a particular form of discrimination. And it was not I, but he, who when he came to Geneva and founded UN Watch, he spoke about the fact that he devoted a certain part of his life to fighting against anti-black, anti-African-American discrimination for civil rights, and then now he headed UN Watch, which has a universal mandate, and also has a particular focus. We are the only organization at the United Nations fighting against the egregious waste of diversion of UN time, resources, and money, and as you all know, very limited, scarce diplomatic resources wasted on a political campaign to demonize Israel. And so many people, including people here on this panel, and as was mentioned, secretaries general have acknowledged this bias. As in Kofi Annan's parting words, he challenged UN bodies, does it really help the Palestinians to do all these things? And so many things that are acknowledged by diplomats, but there's one organization, a very small organization in Geneva, that dedicates not all our time, but a good part of our time, less amount of our time than the United Nations devotes to singling out Israel, to combating this bias. And I think it's entirely correct and legitimate for us to combat this bias, even though, as I understand, you're accusing us of being selective. Now, your next question was, to what extent do we devote time to the Israel-Palestinian conflict? And I think, coming again to the situation of blacks in the South, where Morris Abram grew up, where they used to lynch black people, if black people were being lynched and someone were to pass by a lynching and say, by the way, I'd like to add that the gentleman being lynched also shoplifted and did this, that, or the other, well, that wouldn't be the time and place. And so if you ask me if I'm going to spend time at the Human Rights Council, where Israel is lynched, in the resolutions, in the agenda item, in the emergency sessions, in the egregious biased prejudicial mandates, in the biased special rapporteurs, if I'm going to add another word to join in this lynch mob, I will not. And I think that my silence on these issues, and at times we do speak out, and we have had Palestinians come and speak, but the reason that in my 2 minutes that I have out of 3 hours of NGOs, where as you know there might be 50 or 70 NGOs which will just pile on Israel and echo the talking points issued from Ramallah, from the Palestinian ambassador, and we saw it when Michael Link was almost not appointed, Palestinian ambassador said, this is an outrage, you have to appoint Michael Link, don't you dare listen to you and watch. And we saw NGOs immediately regurgitate his talking points. If you think in my 120 seconds that I have to provide a little bit of balance that I'm going to add and join the lynch mob, I will not do so. And I don't think that is that shows a lack of appropriate behavior in that context. But I think it's absolutely vital that Israel is held to account. I do support the UPR process in regard to Israel, which it has cooperated in both occasions. And I think it is a shame, as was said tonight, it is a shame that Israel and the Palestinians are not treated in a manner that evidences genuine concern, because every country can be improved, is only improved. Israel is strengthened by the fact that they have the most independent and activist judiciary in the world. They are strengthened by the fact that they have perhaps the most aggressive free press in the world, and other institutions of balance. So I think Israel and the Palestinians would be enhanced if there were genuine concern and attention. Sadly, there's not.
Can I just very quickly?
Yeah,
just very quickly. Getting back to the Peruvian example, and I certainly didn't mean to sound patronizing. Indeed, I recognize a lot of competence and good work on some of the treaty-based committees. Having said that, right, the gentleman's question was put in, let's face it, consequential utilitarian terms of does the good outweigh the bad or vice versa. And I agree, you were only naming one example in the Peruvian case. One could name other such examples. But when we see genocides, I mean, to use the UN's own language, gross and systemic situations which are wholly passed over, and indeed, because in order to keep Israel on the agenda and thereby keep together, you know, I have to ask, does the good outweigh the bad? And I don't think that question is so easily answered with a yes. Not at all. In fact, I'm not even sure it comes close. I'm not even sure it's a hard one. And I hate to say this, and that's why I can only get back to the point, you know, at what point are we just being complicit? Because, I mean, if anything, you know, these occasional wins for human rights, such as the example you named, this becomes a kind of window dressing, a kind of justification. It's kind of, well, we, you know, again, this kind of balancing out, which I find strange, when a genocide can be taken off the agenda. So I'm afraid I have to give a bleak answer to your question. And I'm not so sure that, I mean, fine, the UN in its non-human rights activity, you know, I don't know, civil aviation, postal delivery, you know, fine, you need, you know, it's purely technocratic sort of work. As to human rights, I also, when I started teaching human rights, which I gave up, I also did the activist's line of, yeah, well, you know, we have to work with what we've got within the system and progressive reform and, well, you know, not a perfect world. I know all that. I can do that in my sleep. I just don't believe it anymore. And I think we should stop saying it to our students. And we have to, I think, really give them have them take much more seriously the idea that maybe this is a system of complicity, in which we as human rights teachers then become complicit when we're just teaching all of this doctrine, you know, and then, you know, the committee works like this and the council does that, and we teach it, and it's very mechanistic, and, you know, and you know, just balancing the good against the bad. And sorry about the Godwin's law, but in Nazi Germany, they enforced contracts and justice was therefore done. Happy?
Brilliant. Gentlemen in the top out there, do you want to just shout?
Yeah, sure. You talked naturally a lot about the supranatural national institutions in the UN, especially the Secretary General and so on. But of course, the UN is also, on top of that, the individual member states that make it up, and then the ones that have the genuine power to change anything on the ground. And without their support, I think it wouldn't be done. Now, considering that among all those member states, there are a handful, perhaps, since the defeat of the Arab countries in 1973, that are even remotely interested in actually opposing Israel for good or bad reasons. Considering there's an overwhelming support, either support for Israel or just indifference to the conflict among member states, isn't it necessary for the other side of the UN, that is the supranatural bodies, to have a sort of inversely proportional hostility towards Israel in order for the UN as a whole to be more or less balanced on the issue, and for the Palestinians to feel some sort of solidarity with their own cause, and for the Israelis to feel some solidarity with theirs that they receive from member states?
Who wants to take that one first? Yeah, I think so. Kenneth?
I didn't understand your argument.
Okay. I think I'm okay.
There's 2 points I want to make very briefly.
To the question or to Eric? Or to
Yeah.
Because we only have 5 minutes for the.
Okay, go ahead. There were 2 points made here in the panel that I think are important because they echo arguments that I've heard at the United Nations in Geneva. There was discussion by the chair and some others that the question was asked is, it's a body of governments, the Human Rights Council. It's 47 governments. All the others are there, but they don't vote, but they're observer states. They're present, and it's a political body. And what do you expect of a political body? And I find it interesting. And I'm not suggesting that the people here on this panel are making this argument, but there is an argument often made that the moment one challenges the impartiality of this body, they immediately say, "Oh, well, what do you want? It's a political body," and that's kind of an attempt to excuse this body from any accountability. Now, I find it interesting that people, for example, I mentioned William Chavis, who is a professor who teaches here at Middlesex, and he was chairing the Commission of Inquiry of the Human Rights Council in 2014 on the Gaza conflict. And as I said, after about 6 months, he had to resign because it was revealed that he had done paid legal work for the PLO, among other positions that he had taken that were prejudicial. He often said, when he was interviewed during that time, he said, "I listen to the Human Rights Council. I have great respect for the Human Rights Council." So when they're serving in the capacity as a representative or an appointee of the Human Rights Council, they come in the name of what they argue is a great, respectable body, which has all the credibility and legitimacy in the world. And yet at the same time, whenever anyone demands some accountability and living up to the basic standards of the council's own principles, which, as I said, in 2006 require non-selectivity, they say, "Well, it's a political body. What do you want?" So I think that's problematic. And even here in the United States, there's some UN apologetics that we hear where they say, "Well, the United Nations, criticizing the United Nations for inaction on Rwanda genocide, is like criticizing the Madison Square Garden when the Knicks perform poorly, right? It's just an empty room and has no corporate responsibility or action. And of course, these are the same people who will, in other occasions, praise the UN. They'll give a Nobel Peace Prize to the UN. But when you have some legitimate criticism, they say, well, what do you want? It's just an empty vessel, or it's just a political body. And I think that that conflicting stance should be identified. So too, another attempt to evade responsibility is, and again, I'm not attributing that intention to the people on the panel, but when I first arrived in Geneva and I met with High Commissioner Louise Arbour, and I said, why is it that you're silent on Palestinian abuses? She said, well, what do you want? The PLO is, you know, the Palestinian authority is just, it's not a state. It's not a state. So we demand more of a state than a non-state. Actually, the United Nations, as I recall, declared Palestine a state. As I recall, in Geneva, when I speak, sitting in front of me is Ibrahim Qureshi, the representative of l'État de Palestine, the state of Palestine. So once again, we have a very interesting situation that at the United Nations, the ambassador of Palestine, the state of Palestine, according to the United Nations, goes around Geneva in his green Mercedes with diplomatic plates. He's the ambassador of the state of Palestine. So the United Nations wishes to give every privilege to magnify his status. But the moment that you request responsibility, even after Palestine was declared by the United Nations and by Sweden, I think the British Parliament, if I'm not mistaken, the House of Commons a couple years ago, declared that Palestine should be recognized as a state, yes. The moment you come with accountability, they come up with all kinds of statements that, well, it's not actually a state, and somehow to evade responsibility. And Sir Nigel, you mentioned before about Hamas. I asked why you did not say it's a crying shame that the UN ignores abuses by the radical Islamist terrorist regime of Hamas and abuses by Fatah. You said, well, is Hamas a state entity? Well, I don't know if it's a state entity or not. They certainly act in many ways like a state. But that is not a fair question. The UN should be concerned about human rights victims, wherever they are, whoever the abuser is. And in fact, we saw that after 9/11, the Security Council condemned the terrorists who committed the 9/11 attack. And we saw that the Human Rights Council, only a year ago, to their credit, held a special session on the Islamic State, to their credit. And a commission of inquiry of the Human Rights Council declared that what the Islamic State is doing to Yazidi women is a genocide. So when the UN wants to, they can find a terrorist group, ISIS, and say, condemn them and call, accuse them of genocide. But somehow, when it comes to the Palestinian issue, we're not responsible. We're not a state, and somehow they evade responsibility. Everyone can be held to account by the United Nations, no matter what entity they are. Any perpetrator can be held to account. Sadly, in the case of the Palestinians, once again, they get a free pass.
Thank you. Yes, someone's got their hand up really high. Yeah.
Thank you. It's not very surprising that coming to a debate organized by the Friends of Israel Society, the debate talked very, very less on whether the United Nations was fair on its treatment to Palestine. But as a person from a different part of the world, looking at the issue of Israel and Palestine and the intervention of the United Nations, I have a very simple question. A very straightforward question to, and anyone can answer that. Do you really think the United Nations was fair to Palestine in November 1947? And I have a particular question for you, Hillel. It is that, why do you ask the United Nations to stop looking at Israel and then start looking at other countries when you're not really able, when your country is not really able to prove the allegations against your country is wrong? Are you trying to prove that the United Nations is unfair in keeping you off from accountability?
Again, it's simply, it's a rule of law question. Do we or do we not commit ourselves to a system which applies standards even-handedly? Yes or no? I mean, in a domestic legal question, this is, you know, this is week one of law school, and at the United Nations, it seems to be a conceptual impossibility, right? When you know, two people commit the same crime, you accept the same punishment, right?
But we don't. Right? That doesn't happen in domestic law.
No, but it's the ideal.
I know, but it doesn't.
But it's the ideal. That is the rule of law idea. At the United Nations, this is not the ideal. This is not the ideal, right? Now, and so the idea is, you know, I mean, since we could put the question back to you then, right? And how do you feel about the fact, you know, that China can kill literally in the hundreds of thousands in Tibet, not a word? You tell me. What do you think? What do you say to those Tibetans?
No,
say it in a word or two, right? Right, because this is not, in other words, this is not an attempt to take Israel out, to remove it from scrutiny. You won't find people who even want that, right? It's simply said, treat everyone with the same standard. That's simply a rule of law idea. Yes, I know it's not always perfectly implemented, even domestic systems, but it is not meaningless. And it is, as Hillel was rightly saying, it is presupposed by the very notion of a human rights regime. Otherwise, I'd like to know what a human rights regime means, if not even-handed treatment across the board to all perpetrators. So I would put to you, how would you explain to Tibetans that they've never been on the agenda when Israel is on it every year? I'd love to hear that.
I should be answering that question. If we are sitting in a debate where we are discussing the allegations of China or like,
but and how many such debates have you ever attended or seen advertised in any university? When is the last time you saw a UCL at LSC, right? We're going to have a debate. Is the UN fair to Tibetans? Is the UN fair in Rwanda? Is it fair in Darfur? Is it fair in Congo? When's the last time that was ever held?
I
don't know how many debates I've been to. Should we boycott Israel?
No.
So you tell me.
I have been to Israel and Palestine both. Yeah. It's Israel is a terrifying country, and I love the people of Israel. But then, your argument, like, which you raised back, is based on unwarranted assumptions.
My assumption is the rule of law. My assumption is fairness. That's the assumption. That's the assumption. Where are all of these debates on any of these other countries? Where are the boycott debates on any other country and any of our universities? Give me one example, because for Israel, I can name just about every university in Britain and in much of the Western world. I don't think that's nothing. I don't think it's trivial.
I think you can expect it.
What answer would you prefer? What answer would you prefer?
I would rather answer that question.
But that's easy, isn't it? Some people don't have that luxury.
What about the other half of his question?
What was that?
He said, was it fair in
1947?
Okay, Nigel.
Was the whole colonial world fair? Was human history fair? Was the Chinese Empire fair? Was the Japanese Empire fair? Was the Russian Empire fair?
I don't for a moment intend to respond directly in a soundbite to a profound political question, but it is a political question. Israel is a long-standing member of the United Nations and has to be dealt with as any other member of the United Nations. That's all I have to say.
Thank you very much to our panelists and to everyone for turning up and apparently willing to the room of security.